To me, this program is not a journalistic enterprise. It is about learning. Learning from people who have reached the top of their fields about their vision, experience, aspirations, and passions. In all my fields of endeavor, be it business, public service, policy research, or the media, I ask myself three questions. Am I helping to make a difference? Am I doing the best I can? And am I enjoying myself? Take a seat, make yourself comfortable, and let's go. Our last interaction was 20 years ago. We start again.
Yes, it's been quite some time.
Exactly. What was your career path? I know you went from high office to high office since you left Sri Lanka as High Commissioner here 20 years ago.
I was sorry to leave Sri Lanka, but because we were really happy here. But we went to China and then to Pakistan as High Commissioner, and then I went home as Foreign Secretary. One of the nice parts of that was it brought me back in touch with Sri Lanka, and then I was National Security Advisor from 2010 to 2014 in Delhi. Again, we had some work to do together.
The National Security Advisor's responsibilities, for many people internationally, it's an office that a lot of people are interested in knowing about because it gets so much high profile, whether it's in India or in the US or elsewhere. What are the responsibilities of a National Security Advisor?
Well, you know, we were the first parliamentary system to try a National Security Advisor system, set up a National Security Council. And I think the motivation was primarily that today you have security, foreign policy, national security issues, which cut across all the traditional divisions of government, across ministries, to say cybersecurity. This is not just, it's everybody's business, but it's also nobody's business. So you need somewhere where you take a holistic view of national security. And because the National Security Advisor, in our case, is the advisor to the Prime Minister, the American case to the President, to the executive head of the government, so tends to also become a sort of diplomatic advisor to the head of government, or their channel, direct channel, to other heads of government through the NSAs. So there aren't that many NSAs actually in the world. But yes, it is a small club of people who deal with national security at the highest level, take an integrated view, and also perform, you know, whatever functions
the head of government requires. Is there a global network among the NSAs?
There isn't any formal network, but most NSAs know each other and can pick up the phone and talk to each other.
In your period in office, if I were to ask what was maybe one of the most interesting or decisive moments where you were involved in a decision that was
NSA or as Foreign Secretary?
NSA, but if you want, you can include Foreign Secretary as well. I know both were. But
it's very hard to pick one or two. I mean, I frankly enjoyed all my postings, and each of those jobs was fun. I was very lucky, I think, in the jobs I got. I think as Foreign Secretary, of course, one thing that took a lot of effort was the India-US civil nuclear agreement, which was quite a complicated thing to work through, both in India, in the US, and was quite a breakthrough. As National Security Advisor, much of what you do, I think, stays quiet, and by the nature of the job. And I think, but in our time, I think we made a real beginning in terms of cybersecurity, in terms of some of these things which otherwise don't get too much public attention, but are today the foundation of our world almost.
Today, if you were to look at the challenges for India when it comes to national security, from a national security standpoint, you mentioned cybersecurity, but what are the other challenges, as you said?
Well, we are in an interesting position. There's no external existential threat to India anymore. There might have been in the 50s, 60s, when people wondered about India's future and so on. But not really. I mean, today, because India has grown, India has changed, capabilities have grown. Today, it's really internal security issues, because society has changed so fast. All the indices of violence in India, whether it's terrorism, deaths, whether it's security forces, you know, left-wing extremism, etc., all those have actually gone down steadily in this century, except for two things. Crimes against the person, so sort of social violence, you know, rape, this thing. This is against individuals. Partly this is because of the whole dislocation of urbanization, of people being outside their traditional family, clan, village situation. We're now in a whole new, in another 5 years or so, we could well be 50% urban, which would be a huge shift. And so that's the kind of thing that where traditional policing no longer works. Traditional policing was designed for a society where people didn't move, people had one job, stuck to it all their lives, stayed in one place all their lives. They were in a social network which existed. Today, frankly, that's no longer true. You've atomized individuals, and you can see the effect of social media, the way it's brought emotion into politics. It's made things much more volatile and unpredictable. But it also has huge security implications. So therefore, you know, cybersecurity also becomes important. Actually, it's really a clutch of sort of internal security issues that I would say today require the most attention. And this is true of most societies. Not only China today spends more on internal security than she does on national defense.
When it comes to the neighborhood, it's always challenging for any big power to address the neighborhood. You see it across the board, I guess. And in the post-Cold War paradigm, probably India has a larger responsibility within the neighborhood as well. What do you think, what would you say, if you were to do a, because you can, I guess, talk freely now, if you were to do an assessment, what has India done right, what has India done wrong, and what are the lessons to be learned for the future?
I think it took us a long while in the subcontinent for us all to understand that we need to economically integrate and that we do best when we work together as economies. And it took until 85 for us to start SAARC, and even then it's limped along, you know, starting. I think India and Sri Lanka actually set the right example when we did the FTA, negotiated between 1997 and 2000, got into force in 2000. And if you look at it now, I think we, as a subcontinent, it's quite amazing. Officially, we only do 6% of our trade with each other. So it's not very integrated. And yet, if you look at everything else, our borders are porous. We have cross-border ethnicities across each of our borders. None of our borders is an ethnic boundary. I mean, whether it's between India and Sri Lanka, India and Bangladesh, and all the others. The actual trade, which we legally we call it smuggling, is twice as much as the official trade. And frankly, with Nepal, we have a completely open border. With Bhutan as well, trade is completely free. With Bangladesh, most trade is actually duty-free. So I think we're actually heading in the right direction. And if you look at the last decade or so, we've all done very well, especially Sri Lanka, Bangladesh. Sri Lanka got a peace dividend as well. But the only reason we were able, or Sri Lanka was able to go through 26 years of civil war with positive growth rates every year except one, Nepal survived 12 years of civil war, was partly because we did that right, because we had opened our economies to each other, and we took each other along. And I think that's really the way to go, to look at how we integrate. Now, I think the problem is that our sovereign, these are new states in a sense, in a historical sense. So most of us have built our sovereign, our sense of nationhood, and because we are so close, so similar, the affinities are so strong, there's a need to therefore reinforce that sense of nationhood, of othering communities and people and so on. So I think we have to recognize the sensitivity on the political, on the sovereignty side of each of the countries. And there I'm not sure that we've always shown the sensitivity that we should. We meaning all of us, not just India, but all of us. So you have this, you need to do this balancing where you integrate economically, socially, travel, make communications easy. It's good for all of us and it serves us all. But at the same time, you don't want to threaten people's identity. You don't want to question their nationhood or their sense of sovereignty, because these are new and people want to keep this. So especially in an era of mass politics in most of our countries, If you look at it, democracy has actually spread considerably in the last 20 years right through the subcontinent. So for me, actually, I think we're heading in the right direction. There are things we could have done better, but I'm an optimist. If you look at South Asia globally, compare it with the rest of the world, the last two decades we've probably done better than most regions. In fact, we've done as well, if not better, than East Asia. From a much lower base.
Of course, yeah, but still, I mean, even clearly one of the growth centers of the globe. When it comes to SAARC, I mean, it has always been fits and starts for
different.
What is the future of SAARC?
I think we get too obsessed with which organization. This is the how. It's the form. Mm-hmm. For me, it's the outcome and the substance that really matters. You know, whether we do it through SAARC or we do it bilaterally or we do it sub-regionally, three of us, five of us, BIMSTEC, whatever. Whatever works,
feel it
works.
Should be flexible.
And I think we should be flexible and pragmatic. If it works, it works. If it doesn't work, find another way of doing what you want to.
Now, India is a nuclear power, and of course, you are surrounded. Also, there are several existing powers and aspiring powers
in this
region.
This is the most nuclearized part of the world,
exactly.
Asia.
What is the future? Because if you look at the United States now, to some extent, there seems to be revisionist thinking out there as well. There was a tendency to trying to move away from nuclear weapons, but where do you see the future in that field?
Well, I think it's very heavily nuclearized, because if you look at all the nuclear weapon states present or active in the Indian Ocean and the Asian continent itself, there's, you know, Russia, China, India, Pakistan, there's undeclared nuclear states like Israel. So there's a whole. And, of course, the U.S. doesn't confirm or deny whether her nuclear weapons are in the region at all. So, yes, it's heavily nuclearized, but I think increasingly, and one reason there's been this taboo against use of nuclear weapons since 1945, which no one has actually broken, is because people increasingly realize that nuclear weapons deal with one end of the spectrum. They neutralize other nuclear weapons. But they are not the answer to any other parts of the spectrum of violence, not to conventional warfare or to asymmetric, to other forms of warfare, whether it's cross-border terrorism, etc. So I think the function of nuclear weapons is to make sure that other nuclear weapons can't be used to threaten you, to change your behavior, to. And that's why I think India, China are willing to say no first use, because they're not going to use this to try and compensate for a conventional imbalance or for something else, or as an umbrella for other things they might want to do. And I think that's really increasingly the function. And to that extent, so long as deterrence works and nuclear weapons prevent the use of other nuclear weapons, actually, that's not a bad state to be. And so far, at least, I assume that people are not suicidal. And so while threats might be made, things might be said, but so far at least that taboo against the use has actually held.
The world, I mean, I think today, in a general sense, international relations experts, I think you have the pessimists and you have the optimists, I guess. Yeah. Where do you stand on that sort of scale?
Sure,
and
I mean,
what is your?
I just have to think of where the world was when I was born and where it is today. Where India was when I was born and where it is today. And I can't help but be an optimist. I mean, when I look around me, there's no question that more people live better, longer, healthier, more productive, more comfortable lives than ever before in history. I think that there's no question. Yes, there are threats. But then we've always had threats. I mean, human beings have always had trouble getting along with each other. We've always had struggles for power, for dominance, but we've handled them in the past, and I don't see why we can't. So for me, at least, my experience at least suggests that you should be an optimist. But then, you know, there's a whole industry in pessimism. I mean, there are whole parts of the official structures of the state whose only job is to think bad thoughts, and their budgets and their jobs depend on it. So there will always be this worry, this scare.
Your point earlier on about sort of moving away, or at least thinking outside the traditional structures like SAARC and others. I mean, that obviously makes a lot of sense, because we have entered a new world technologically, right. And the way, even if you look at India, you have a diaspora all over the world.
30 million people actually scattered around.
How do you see, what is the, in the new context, how should we organize ourselves on a global level? Is the United Nations still relevant in that context, if we are talking about SAARC? If so, how is it
personally relevant? Think less and less, because many of the functions, you see, UN is basically an organization of states. And it's a hierarchical organization which tried to freeze the hierarchy that existed after World War II by giving the five vetoes and by having a Security Council which, you know, takes decisions on behalf of other people and so on. And today's world is increasingly flat for various reasons. The distribution of power is no longer what it was then. If you look at it objectively, thanks to the rise of China, other emerging economies, India now sixth largest, fifth largest probably, Japan, etc., it's what? The world is multipolar economically. After all, commodity markets, prices, etc., depend actually on what happens in several places, not just. The U.S. share of world GDP is still roughly about 25% and has stayed there, you know. But Europe's share has gone way down. China is now around 18% or so. If you add China and India together in PPP terms, we're actually equal to or a little more than the U.S. in the global economy. So the world is multipolar economically. Militarily, it's still very unipolar. You know, the Royal Navy used to have a two-navy standard. They wanted to be bigger than the next two navies put together. The U.S. Navy is equivalent to the next 16 navies put together. It's a 16-navy standard. The U.S. defense budget is equivalent to the next 8 countries all put together. So, you know, the world is unipolar militarily, multipolar economically. Politically, it's thoroughly confused. If I were to ask you, what's the world order today, political? Nobody has an answer. And so I think you're at a moment of disjuncture, of sort of phase change. The state is doing less and less of what the state used to be, completely dominant in international relations. And yet now, you know, whether it's assigning domain names, ICANN does it, it's a private corporation which does it, whether it's energy flows, whether it's the flow of information, you know, the big four technology companies, and now if you add the Chinese, you know, you say the big nine, you know, these have powers which nobody, I mean, 93% of our, we were discussing maritime security, 93% of our information flows actually of what goes on the internet goes through undersea cables. Now, there's no jurisdictions involved here. This is really a completely different world where things are decided between corporations, between individuals, and ideas flow freely, and you can't control this. And as I said, there's a huge social churn going on as well.
The regulatory, in that context, I suppose the states have some regulatory responsibility, because this whole argument now on Facebook and about the Googles and the Amazons is coming up. How do you think, how does one cope with that without becoming overly repressive and oppressive when it comes to managing this?
Well, you know, I think regimes which want more control tend to say it should be under sovereign control and within sovereign boundaries. We have complete sovereignty. But that's obviously not either technically possible. Even the Great Firewall can be breached and is breached every day by millions of people. So I think the problem there is that we don't have a model of internet governance which is acceptable across the world. There are at least three ideas, multiple stakeholders, which is the American and the Indian idea, for instance, of letting those who have stakes in the system to actually run it, decide, take decisions. The other extreme, which is what Russia, China would like, essentially sovereign governments to have control and take those decisions. And there's the European model in between, which tries a sort of supranational organization, but still an organization of states, and which will lay down regulations and so on. I'm not sure where we'll go. I think ultimately the decision will be taken by people, individual decisions adding up to a collective decision, and by how technology evolves.
Do you feel now?
I don't think the technology can be controlled.
Clearly. That's
so when we talk of governance, it's not governance in the traditional sense.
But do you feel that now, when it comes to the UN, the debate is always there about the Security Council, and it was an institution for another time, clearly.
Well, I am a minority in India. I think it's a waste of time chasing a Security Council seat, frankly.
But when you move to the new paradigm, that is, in the technology sense, do you feel the mechanisms that are available to regulate these can be done without going back to the UN type of structure, but that they would be more open? I mean, countries like India would have a stronger
say. I think things like this will evolve. Just like, you know, markets evolved. Mm. And they weren't the product of one brilliant mind or one government saying, okay, this is how markets will work. You look at commodity markets, which do a pretty efficient job. Or even the way we distribute taxes within our societies, mm-hmm. you know, how much is used by whom. These are things that have evolved over time. And it's the result of several little decisions actually aggregating into something.
So you feel people will sort it out? They'll find.
I think it will have to, because people will make mistakes. They'll find that this doesn't work. They'll have to find another way of dealing with it.
The other area is that I was reading an article recently in the Washington Post by Robert Kagan from mm-hmm. Brookings.
Yeah.
He says the
Return
strong,
of the Jungle.
Exactly. And the strong men strike back. Yeah. That is one of his...
Well, I agree with him that we have a phenomenon of new authoritarians. That's been going on. It's probably a consequence of globalization. Because globalization in many societies, like India, China, and so on, Japan, even in the U.S., represented a threat to identity. This idea that somehow foreigners, that now suddenly everything was in your living room or in the palm of your hand on your smartphone, and you felt, therefore, you had to assert your own identity, that foreigners were taking your jobs. So you got actually new authoritarian, so-called populists. They're not actually populists. Who would then offer a solution, saying, I'm a strong leader, I'll fix this. Then none of them have shown the ability to fix it yet. But it started in Asia, and with Abe, Xi Jinping, Modi, Putin, you know. I think the U.S. was probably the last to actually do that with Trump. But you do have new authoritarian leadership around the world who have made great promises. Now, at what stage do we, you know, do people say, okay, what happened? I'm not sure where this is going to end politically. Because you're torn. You are in a globalized world, whether you like it or not. For most of us, our economies depend on the rest of the world. We are tied in multiple ways, not just trade and investment, but technology, by our ideas. You know, what the medium that we are using now. All these are global. So you're in a globalized world, but you want to maintain your local identity. You want to strengthen it. You want to defend it. You want jobs to be kept local. I mean, you're fighting what digital manufacturing, AI, all the changes that you can see, the energy revolution, all these are global phenomena. And so that tension, I'm not sure how you're going to resolve.
But because I suppose people want, obviously, personal security is very important.
Right.
And a sense of predictability around you, which I suppose increasingly technology is removing that from us. How would you achieve that balance? Because I agree with you. I mean, I think maybe we are just shifting in another direction because people are not sure where to go. But
you know, I have a simple example. Our ideas of privacy have changed completely. Mm-hmm. And they've evolved in the last 20 years. In the old days, nobody read your mails, right? Gentlemen didn't read each other's letters. Now your email is open and you assume that everybody reads your emails, including any snooping government, any individual, the corporations. I mean, today we write very differently because of that assumption. But we've made that adjustment already in our minds, most of us. Or else we don't care. All this stuff we do on social media, this performance that, you know, many people use social media for, which they couldn't do 20 years ago. So we've already changed our ways of working, our ways of living, our ways of thinking and interacting with each other. And that, I think, will just go on. And so we now take it for granted that we're in a globalized world. I think the real problem is going to come actually out of a different set of, you know, if you look at mega cities and their growth, cities over 10 million people, you now have about 43 cities in the world. 70% of the world's population lives within 200 miles of the sea. You have global warming, climate change, sea rise. You have a whole, where mankind is actually being concentrated physically into smaller and smaller spaces. When you look at the urbanization, you look at what's happening. And that's a very different situation from what we're used to, the sense of individual space, of freedom, of many of the ideas that we are brought up on. And we're going to have to live very differently. We'll have to organize our politics differently also. Because politics then becomes a politics of emotion, of the mob, of, you know, of sudden waves of feeling rather than... And social media and so on make that possible.
How has diplomacy changed since you started your career?
Diplomacy is, you know, fundamentally the same. Because what you have different tools. You have communication, you have means of communication, you have all kinds of other things to do. But the basic task of a diplomat is to negotiate an outcome which works for both sides. If the other side has no interest in the outcome, they're not going to implement it. So it's no use to you. Winning 100% is no use. You need to actually both come at something through negotiations peacefully, without actually forcing somebody or beating him on the head, to come to an outcome which works for both of you. In different proportions, but whatever, it has to leave you. You have to leave the table with something. That job only individuals and people can do. No machine is going to take that over.
Is still as relevant as it was before?
You still need one. It's possible to do a lot more by flying in, flying out, talking to people, you know, using whatever, FaceTime, Skype. You have technology which makes your job easier. But ultimately, you still need to do the hard work. It is still a people business. Just like politics also, I don't think politicians or diplomats are in any danger of losing their jobs.
Sadly, maybe. Well, the politicians, really? Actually, some people will say that. If a young person wanting to start a career in diplomacy comes to you for advice, what would your advice be to him or her?
Well, you know, I loved the career. In fact, I didn't mean to be a diplomat. I was studying China, doing a PhD on ancient India in China, and I wanted to see China. And that's why I thought I'd do the exam, go and see China, go back to the PhD. But I love the job so much. So I'm very biased. I would immediately encourage them. But there's three parts to this. One is, as I said, it's a people business. So if you're not gregarious, if you don't enjoy people, I think, you know, then it's maybe not the profession for you. So that's the first. Secondly, you must enjoy change and strange places and travel. And, you know, it's physically quite demanding as a profession. It doesn't seem so when you're young, but as you get older, it does. But if you like those two things and you like working with other people, then it's the ideal profession. But keep an open mind. Not everyone is going to think like you, be like you. If you enjoy that, if you enjoy the process of understanding other people, of working with other people, of getting them to see things your way, then it's the ideal profession. And that those basics have not changed. So it's interesting, if you go back and read the old texts, I mean, go back to Kautilya and so on, what a diplomat does today is still the same. And it's quite remarkable how similar it is. Or you go back to Harold Nicholson, you know, the beginning of the last century. It's still the same, what we do. So it's quite, I mean, I find that quite amazing, actually.
Shankar Menon, thank you very much for joining.
Not at all. Thank you. It was a pleasure.